to right and left hand buttons. The buttons.
Hello, and before you ask, yes, it really is as cold as it looks. Temperatures in this corner of Scandinavia have dipped to below minus 30 degrees Celsius this last week, which means conditions for this year's International Swedish Rally will be challenging, to say the very least. The 2001 World Championship got off to an incident-packed start in the south of France a couple of weeks ago, when Peugeot suffered the bitter disappointment of losing all three of their cars on the first morning. By the end of the day, they'd been joined by the three Subarus. Colin McRae retired while leading on the final morning, leaving Tommi Makinen to pick up the maximum 10 World Championship points by taking his third successive victory on the Monte Carlo Rally. A string of wins here in Sweden in recent years means that Makinen will start as favourite this weekend. But 12 months ago, this event saw Marcus Gronholm's maiden World Rally victory, so it could be an all-Finnish affair. This event, in fact, has never been won by a non-Scandinavian, but despite that fact, it's an event which is high on the list of favourites of both the leading British drivers.
I mean, this one and Finland's another one that's very difficult to win, but yeah, for sure it'd be a bit of extra satisfaction if you beat the Scandinavians on their own soil.
I can be competitive here, and so automatically I'm confident, and that's what you need in this kind of stage. And if the equipment is good, if the Pirelli tyres are good, which we know they're an improvement over last year, and the car we know is an improvement over last year because we didn't even have the 2000 car this time last year. So everything put together means that we could come away with a good result, yeah.
It's difficult to drive when it is snowing at the time when you're on the stage, but obviously it's going to make the conditions better. It looks, so far, it's been the best conditions we've seen for a long time in Sweden.
After his win in Monte Carlo, Tommi Makinen came to Sweden full of confidence and relishing the snowy conditions.
It's always nice to be in proper snow conditions, big banks, of course it's also difficult to keep good speed, but it's of course much more safety. Not even you make some little mistake, slide bit off, you normally come back on the road.
The wintry scenery also found favour with last year's Swedish Rally winner.
It's one of my favourite rallies for sure, and now it's the same situation as last year. We came here without any points from Monte Carlo, so I hope we can do the same now.
For the first time, Gronholm was joined by fellow Finn Harri Rovanpera, although the newcomer wasn't nominated to score manufacturer points. Another team had also elected to run a third car for a specialist. In Mitsubishi's case, it was the local hero.
Well, you have to go flat out from the start and then be very lucky because the speed is quite high and you need to, of course, to take some risks on here and some there.
Another Swede led the Hyundai Challenge on the team's final event with the current Accent World Rally car.
I don't think it's any more pressure really, you know, than normal, but of course you want to do specifically well here, and I won the rally three times, so I think you have it in the blood to really go well here.
Also competing in Sweden, alongside Ben Bryant in a Group N Mitsubishi, was Blue Peter presenter Konnie Huq.
Three legs over 3 days, 17 stages totaling 380 kilometres of flat-out competition, with the six stages of leg one due north of the rally headquarters in Karlstadt. Championship leader Tommi Makinen led the crews into the opening stage, knowing that, as is so common, running first on the road would be a disadvantage as he would have to sweep away the loose snow. The Finn was a frustrated 13th. While running down the order, his Swedish teammate Thomas Radstrom, nominated by Mitsubishi to score manufacturer's points, was an impressive 4th. Freddy Loix in the third Evo 6 was an embarrassed 34th. studs, and what length you chose would be crucial for competitors throughout the rally. And if anyone could guess right, it should be last year's winner, Marcus Gronholm. And true to form, his Peugeot was fastest on stage one. Didier Auriol, suffering from the flu, was eighth, while team new boy Harri Rovanpera, an impressive sixth, and an even more impressive fastest on stage two to take the lead of the rally. Carlos Sainz in the leading Ford Focus was a solid third overall after the first three stages. But Francois Delacour was way down in 12th, having met a large rock on stage one. Transmission problems left Armin Schwartz's Skoda struggling down in 17th, three places behind teammate Bruno Thierry, while Alistair McRae's Hyundai was 8th, Kenneth Eriksson 6th. Richard Burns' Subaru was just 4 seconds behind Gronholm on stage one, but on stage two...
Come on! Looking at me!
Colin McRae's Focus was one of six cars to pass the stricken Subaru. Over 13 minutes had been lost. But Gronholm wouldn't be one to benefit from Burns' dramas.
Engine is broken, so funny. It's the same problem, I think, what we had in Monte Carlo.
But we thought the team had sorted that out.
Yes, I thought also, but no, exactly the same on the stage. It was funny, but I don't understand why.
Colin McRae was third fastest on stages one and two, but if he was laughing about Burns' demise... wasn't for long. Colin chose to lead the lifting party himself. Five and a half precious minutes were lost, and Burns and McRae were now 71st and 48th overall. So, after three stages, there was a surprising leader, with Thomas Radstrom at the top of the order.
On the second stage, I just braked too late for a junction in a very tight corner, and I knew I couldn't get around the corner. I got turned in, hit the bank on the outside, but just went straight through the bank and got stuck. There was only a few people there, four or five people, but they did everything they could to help us out, but it took 13 minutes, and, well, there we go.
The cars in front have been hitting the snowbanks a lot. When we came, we hit it, but it gave way, and we got sort of bellied out on top of it.
You're leading the rally.
Yes, it's just to try to concentrate to stay in the line, but it's not so easy.
This next one, 50 kilometres. How difficult is it going to be?
Well, you know, it's a 50k stage, but I like it very much. It's quite fast, and I hope it will go well there.
One of the longest stages in the entire championship saw Rodstrom's lead cut to 3.5 seconds, but the Swede was still the quickest Mitsubishi driver. Makinen was seventh quickest, his fourth place now under threat from Kenneth Eriksson, 0.3 seconds separating the pair. Stage four, however, saw the team's other car take its turn to visit a snowbank. While Loikes lost over 3 minutes in the snow, Colin McRae was out to claw back some of the 5.5 minutes he'd lost on stage three. The Scot was fastest, 10 seconds up on everyone else. His teammates Carlos Sainz and Lewis Moyer were third fastest, the onboard camera conveying some of the incredible speed of the event. Richard Burns was the man splitting the two Fords, second quickest but still 53rd overall. Ninth placed Petter Solberg was now Subaru's hope for points, and his caution was clear to see. Gronholm might already be on his way home, but Peugeot now had two cars in the top six. Rovanpera third, the trailing rear bumper rapidly becoming a familiar sight. The flu-ridden Didier Auriol, meanwhile, had leapt from 10th to 6th on stage four. The other silver cars weren't having such a good day. Ericsson's Hyundai might have been mixing it with Makinen, but Alistair McRae's sick-sounding car limped through the stage, a broken turbopipe dropping McRae and co-driver David Senior to 16th place. At least Alistair was still 12 places and 3 minutes better off than his brother, but Colin was putting a brave face on things. How frustrated are you that had you had not had the problem this morning, you'd now be leading?
Yeah. Well, that's the way it goes, isn't it? Ironic.
What's the plan now then? Carry on at this sort of pace, see if you can get back on the leaderboard?
Yeah, that's all we can do, see if we can get back in the points.
We thought you'd be up there fighting, but well, you're fourth, something like 20 seconds behind.
Yes, it is. I think it is. It's been a little bit more slippy to being first, and tomorrow, for sure, it will be better.
We are much closer than I thought, you know. I'm surprised, you know, but I have. There has been a lot of development over Monte Carlo with the rally, Monte Carlo rally with the cars, so I'm pleased with that.
Ericsson departed, leaving the mechanics to concentrate on fixing his colleague's car. To no one's surprise, the wound-up Colin McRae was fastest on both stages 5 and 6, helped by running so far down the order, and the development work done by Pirelli, McRae and Nicky Grist were flying. Burns was second fastest on both stages, but his Swedish rally had turned into nothing more than a test. At the end of the day, Ericsson would be sixth, his challenge having faded slightly. Makinen's Mitsubishi was now 6 seconds ahead of the Hyundai, but the Finn still couldn't afford to relax. Fourth quickest on the day's final stage meant that Didier Auriol and co-driver Denis Girardet would start leg two in fourth place, while the early leaders, Thomas Radstrom and Tina Turner, had dropped to third.
Fourth left lot. 150. 24th right lot. 24th right lot. 150.
Another of the manufacturer new boys, Harri Rovanpera, would return to Karlstadt in second place, the car now minus a rear bumper altogether. But it was a Spaniard, not a Scandinavian, who led. Carlos Sainz was a little over 13 seconds ahead of Rovanpera, but seemed less than delighted.
Tommy and myself, we have been suffering, especially Tommy today. These stages are still cleaning a bit, but somebody has to be the first one.
Perfect day. First day anyway, and everything's going well, and I'm very happy. And but anyway, tomorrow is long second day, and if tomorrow evening is position is same, and between Carlos or Pauline tomorrow, we don't know yet, but that's okay.
It's quite difficult, and I mean, I haven't done a rally since Portugal, so you never know if you are on the limit or 80% or whatever.
41.6 seconds covered the top six, with Colin McRae now 20th and Richard Burns a lowly 34th.
Leg two was once again six stages, the longest 34 kilometres, the shortest just two, but every kilometre counts. Rally leader Carlos Sainz now had that unenviable task of sweeping the loose snow away and could only manage 4th and 11th fastest on the first two stages, where teammate Colin McRae continued to blitz the opposition, 8 seconds faster than anyone else. François Delacour couldn't match his teammate's pace, but he nevertheless moved from 7th to 5th at the expense of Ericsson's Hyundai and the Frenchman's compatriot Didier Auriol, who still wasn't feeling any better. While Harri Rovanpera reduced Sainz's lead to just 0.3 seconds. Thomas Radstrom lost time with a slight off on stage 7. He dropped 4 seconds to Rovanpera and now faced the prospect of team leader Tommi Makinen breathing down his neck just 2 seconds behind him. Like McRae, Richard Burns was on an all-out charge. Standing too close was not a good idea. Day two didn't go well, though, for the man who is now the leading British driver.
Go ahead, Alistair.
Yeah, Mark, we're about 8Ks in. I don't know what's got. I think the engine's in slowdown. It's starting to blow oil out the front. It's on 3 cylinders. Water temperature's all right. The oil pressure seems okay at the moment. If it starts to drop, I'll stop.
Get off now.
Well, I think with obviously we had the engine went. I think maybe it's hold a piston, blew all the oil out the engine, and that was it.
Armin Schwartz's Skoda was another that wouldn't reach the day's first service.
There was one corner where the snowbank was a bit softer, so the rear pulled actually the whole car into the snow, and then we went over the snowbank and we got stuck there, and that's it.
The top four were now covered by just 12 seconds, with the seesawing battle for 5th, 6th and 7th over half a minute behind.
3/10 of a second now between you and Harri.
Yeah, it's quite tight. Also Tommy and Thomas catching up, so looking tight.
But you always enjoy a battle.
Yes.
Fight is starting today morning, sure, and Tommy coming with good position in the rear quite fast, and we'll see what happened this afternoon.
The stage are absolutely fantastic and fast, very, very fast. And I think the next stage will be very interesting because it's a long one, and many drivers know very well this stage, and you have to be careful and to be fast.
With temperatures hovering around minus 14 degrees, keeping warm was a high priority for the spectators. The rally leaders must have also been suffering a little from the cold, but the air inside their Ford Focus would soon be a little warmer. Stalling the car dropped Sainz to fourth, and so it was Harri Rovanpera who now led. The two Mitsubishis also benefited. Thomas Radstrom and Tina Turner were second after stage 10, Radstrom sporting a natty line in designer shades. Tommi Makinen and his co-driver, Risto Manisenmäki, were third, yet the top three places were covered by just over 10 seconds. Behind Sainz, the remaining points positions were occupied by Francois Delacour, who was fifth, and Kenneth Eriksson's Hyundai, now sixth, ahead of Didier Auriol. Eighth-placed Petter Solberg, meanwhile, stood to gain 1 point for his team and so was driving to finish, but his team leader had no such concerns. Second on both stages 9 and 10, Burns was out to prove a point. It was a similar story for Colin McRae, now up to 12th after setting the fastest times on the seventh stage in succession. So, at service in Grangersburg, there were two talking points. The private battle between Burns' Subaru and McRae's Ford, and the four-way scrap at the head of the leaderboard.
I think it's much better to fight like this because both have to concentrate and you know you have to go for it, and then there is no time for thinking.
Do you allow the thought to cross your mind that had you not had the problem in the snowbank yesterday, you'd now be, what, second behind Colin?
Yep, I thought about that.
Once or twice?
But there's nothing I can do, and I'm sure Colin thinks the same thing.
One thing you can say, really, that you're going to get the winner of this rally come out of the top five, but the fastest guy in the whole event is running at the bottom end of the top 10, that's for sure. That's us. We're still having fun and showing the boys how it's done, really.
But a poor tyre choice for the last pair of stages meant the Ford pair's storming run had run out of steam. Makinen was quickest on stage 11, but the next, the rally's 12th, was a 2 km super special, which saw Rovanpera set the fastest time and so consolidate his lead. As the cars reached service in Grangersburg at the end of leg two, thoughts were already starting to turn to the final day.
I'm very happy it's a possible leading, but it's a start position tomorrow morning, that is not the best one, but what we can do. We are fastest car today and that's it.
I will go flat out. That is clear. It's no question, and at least I have a little advance to Harri because I'm second car, he's first car, and maybe that makes it a bit easier.
For third place Thomas Radstrom, the team motorhome provided a welcome chance to thaw out. What will happen tomorrow? Have the team said you must finish behind Tommy or what?
Nothing. Just keep the throttle wide open and then we will see the result.
1 minute 26 seconds covered the top six. Colin McRae's string of stage wins meant that he was now 11th, while Richard Burns was still 21st.
Day three would only have five stages, but there were still nearly 100 kilometres of competitive motoring left. And while the top three Scandinavians joked before the start, their cars showed just how intense the competition was. While one Finn wanted his 22nd victory, the other wanted his first. Plenty of snow had fallen, and it was now Harri Rovanpera's turn to clear the way. Yet he still managed the second fastest time, beaten only by a carefree Burns.
Sata kaks. Vain pitkä vasen K. Vähän plus ja aukee. Sata.
The difference with day three was that the snow was still falling, so conditions remained the same for all. And on shorter studs, Makinen actually dropped 10 seconds to his less celebrated compatriot, while Radstrom fell another 4 seconds behind his Mitsubishi team leader and now had to worry about a charging Carlos Sainz, who, after two stages, closed within 6 seconds of the Swede. Exactly 1 year ago, the Peugeot team gave a new Finnish star his first World Championship win, and it looked like they're about to repeat the fairy tale.
Do you think you've got Tommy beaten now?
We will see. We three long stages and second time this next two, and that is not so easy, sure.
We really want to win this rally, so I'm sure that it will be very good battle in these three stages what's rest.
We are not fighting with Tommy. We will try to keep Carlos behind if it's possible, but we will also not risk to go off the road, because I mean it's points for Mitsubishi that we are here to make.
Harry's going very fast. It's going faster than ourselves and the Mitsubishi's, and well, I'm trying to catch Thomas if possible.
But that service halt had its share of dramas. A gearbox change for Sainz's teammate caused a few anxious moments. But in the main, ace mechanics like these know what's expected of them, even when it's this cold. Off went McRae, penalty free. Stages 15 and 16 were reruns of the previous two, but this time Rovanpera's tyre choice wasn't so decisive. The 206 was 12th fastest on the first, and so Makinen was able to claw back a couple of seconds, only to lose them again on the next. This particular battle, it seemed, was set to go down to the wire. Despite Tina Turner's comment, Radstrom was now closing on his teammate again, while Sainz was still threatening. With one stage remaining, less than 30 seconds covered the top four. The gear change was still causing concern for McRae, but just 7 seconds now stood between Colin and Kenneth Eriksson, and another manufacturer point. No such concerns for Richard Burns and co-driver Robert Reed, fastest on all four of the day stages so far. Marco Martin made it a Subaru 1-2 on both stages 15 and 16, while Petter Solberg, in the unfamiliar role of leading Subaru driver, was taking it easy, most of the time.
Titans, early six right, opens, 50, half three right.
By now, Didier Auriol was out of the battle. Compounding the misery for Peugeot, their second nominated driver joined their first, Gronholm, on the retirement list. This time, though, it was the transmission, not the engine, which let go.
We are still running with some reliability problems. Engine problem first day for Marcus, transmission today for Didier. Engine problem in Monte Carlo for Marcus. So at the end of the second rally of the 2001 season, Peugeot has no points.
Most eyes were now on the fight for victory, but there was another battle going on for fifth place. Francois Delacour's Ford would tackle that last stage just 6.3 seconds ahead of Tony Gardemeister's privately run Peugeot. The Frenchman, however, had no excuses. He simply didn't know where the time was going.
I think it will be difficult to keep the fifth at the moment, because I lose so much in the stage. I don't know why. It's me, I don't know, is something wrong on the car, I don't know at the moment. But in any case, I would like to keep this five position.
One stage left. You've got all the support with you.
Yeah, but the most important thing, we have 3 points for Subaru now, and I can't start to fool around now. The points is the most important thing.
So you won't be pushing to get into the top six?
I'm going to drive sensible speed.
Even though you've not been fighting for a top 10 place, motivation doesn't seem to have been a problem.
No, in the stages I have no problem at all. It's just pure concentration and pure fun.
For Harri Rovanpera, it was just 21 kilometres to a dream come true. He just had to keep it steady while Makinen gambled all on a last stage charge. A tight left followed by a tight right saw the Mitsubishi's tail just swing out too far. The Finn's Mitsubishi was buried in the snow, and the team were very grateful they had nominated Thomas Radstrom for championship points. Thomas, or Tommy, Carlos Sainz now had his sights set on the podium.
I was pushing very, very hard. Unfortunately, this right corner, it was just snap over there quickly, and it was so fast, it was no power enough to pull front back on the road, and the snowbank get through and rolled over. We lost good second place, at least we lost it then. So it's rallying, I try to do what I could do, but sometimes it happens.
So Tony Gardemeister added a fourth to his fifth in Monte Carlo. François Delacour a fifth to his third. While Petter Solberg not only got the 4 points for Subaru, but also 1 point for himself. Kenneth Eriksson held on to finish eighth and give Hyundai 3 points, while Colin McRae struggled on to earn Ford 2, still handicapped by gearbox that didn't want to do what he wanted it to. Without his off, Richard Burns would have won by over 2 minutes. But at least Tommi Makinen wasn't walking away with a 20-point lead over both him and McRae. For Peugeot, there was the satisfaction of a great victory, but it was tinged with the frustration of still not scoring any points for themselves.
On a gagné le rallye.
You made it look almost easy on that final day.
Not so easy, but we are very lucky all day, and no any problems, and not mistakes, and this way I see it's coming good result also.
When I came over the crest, it was spectators waving me down, and then I understood that somebody was there. Unfortunately, it was Tommy, but afterwards, after I passed him, I start more or less to shake a bit and was thinking I must take this car to the finish now.
I'm quite pleased with the result. Obviously, I would like to be fighting for winning the rally, but one stage before the end, I was 11 seconds from Makinen, 3 times winning here, big specialist of this rally, so I'm pleased with the result.
Two drivers without regular seats stood on top of the final leaderboard, separated in the end by nearly 30 seconds, while Sainz failed to snatch second by just 9. And Konnie and Ben made it home a commendable 37th, 11th in their class. There's now a 3-way tie at the top of the Drivers' Championship and still no sign of Gronholm, Oriel, McRae or Burns. Mitsubishi's clever tactics give them a 9-point lead over Ford, while Bruno Thierry grabbed the final point for Skoda to keep them ahead of Hyundai, Subaru and, oh yes, Peugeot.
So, once again, the World Rally Championships pulled an unwelcome last-minute surprise on one of its drivers. After 2 rounds, it seems the pre-season form book's been turned on its head. The favourites, among them Mr. Gronholm, Mr. Burns and Mr. McRae, would be hoping for better fortunes on round 3 in the sunshine of Portugal.